My face is beautiful, thank you. Okay. I know that's gonna end up in the video. Cyberpunk 2077 Phantom Liberty is releasing, and you wanna know how well the game will run on your PC. Is Night City on the menu for you tomorrow? Is your appetite bigger than your PC can handle? Let's find out. The time is finally here, guys. Cyberpunk 2077 Phantom Liberty is releasing tomorrow, and we are about to be graced with the awesomeness of an improved Keanu Reeves and the new edition of Idris Elba. It's like an old school version of Teen Beat magazine. I know Brian even has this issue, but it's like for 40 somethings, which makes me feel old. Regardless of the epic nature of having these two actors in one gaming masterpiece, Cyberpunk has become a bit of a legend when it comes to, can your PC run this game? It's like the crisis of modern day. But with the question, can your rig run Cyberpunk? Well, can it? With a Cinderella-like comeback story, it's cool to see Cyberpunk fever at an all-time high. And again, the question so many people are asking, will it run on my system and just how well? Okay, well, maybe not everyone's mind, but if you're watching this video, I can assume it's actually on yours. Now, we learned a lot from the last time we did a video on can your PC run a game with Starfield, and we're taking a much better approach to helping you decide if the system you have has all the right cyberware to ensure that it is capable of enjoying a romp around Night City or the new expansion Phantom Liberty. So here's what we did. We used the minimum spec, the recommended spec, and the other specs listed in this chart from CD Projekt Red to see what your experience would be like in the game. Which, now that we think about it, made way more sense than just pricing out a bunch of modern day systems. Sorry guys, we will aim to do better, and yes, we read all the comments and feedback, no matter how painful they can be. Also, based on your feedback, we added all the pertinent information on screen via MSI Afterburner so you can see CPU usage, GPU usage, and all the other bells and whistles. So without further ado, let's jump in. So starting off with the minimum spec, we have both an Intel and an AMD CPU option for the game. Given we only have so much time, and to ensure this came out in a timely manner, we only ran one of the CPU options, but we ran all three GPU options, including the one for NVIDIA, AMD, and Intel, which will actually have the higher frame rate variance. So flushing out our test bench, we had the AMD Ryzen 5 1600, an ASUS TUF Gaming B550M Plus Mobo, a 1TB Gen 4 NVMe drive, and 16 gigs of 3200 megahertz DDR4 RAM from T-Force. For the GPUs, we had the Intel Arc A380, the AMD RX 580, and the NVIDIA GeForce RTX 1060. For settings, we went off the preset that CD Projekt Red recommended in the chart. For minimum spec, we did low presets with no ray tracing and at 1080p resolution, and then we scaled the settings, resolutions, and features as we went up the ladder provided by CD Projekt Red for PC requirements for the game. So kicking it off with the min spec, we ran both native and with AI upscaling, which in this case was either XeSS for Intel or FSR for the NVIDIA GTX 1060 or the RX 580. CDPR says that you should expect around 30 frames per second natively if this is similar or close to your spec when set to low visual settings. But a chart is one thing, let's see how these whole things actually perform. Starting off with the Intel Arc A380 at low graphical presets, no ray tracing, and no upscaling, we saw the game playable at just under 50 FPS. Not bad for the entry-level Intel card. Things jumped up to almost 60 frames per second when we added XeSS to the mix. At that point, we were seeing an average of around 57 frames per second. For the RX 580, we saw a similar story to the Intel Arc A380. Same preset as the Intel Arc, we saw the game natively run at an average FPS of 46 at 1080p, meaning playable for sure at this resolution. If you wanted to get closer to that magical 60 FPS number, you can turn on FSR 2.1 and get your average up to just north of 57 frames per second. It is going to make a smoother experience if you aren't susceptible to seeing the differences when using AI upscaling. Finally, on the minimum spec side, we get the card from Team Green. Even though this is the card that should be the most tuned experience for Cyberpunk 2077, we saw the lowest raw frame rate of the three cards for the GTX 1060 at 45 FPS. Still a playable frame rate for sure if you want to play natively. However, even though this is the lowest in raw performance, we saw the largest uplift from upscaling when we applied FSR 2.1 to the GTX 1060, getting just shy of 60 FPS. Now remember, NVIDIA DLSS is a 20 series or higher feature, so we need to use AMD's upscaler for the 1060. Just as a reminder, and a little bit weird. Now here is this nice little chart showing the minimum spec cards from CDPR's chart and the performance for both native and for upscaling. It looks like these are all well north of the expected average from CDPR, and it's also cool to see Intel being at the top of the chart on native. Good job, Intel. Now, where's Battlemage? On to recommended specs. This is what CDPR is saying is the ideal spec for you to enjoy the game at high-end gaming presets with no ray tracing. Ray tracing has a different set of requirements, and we're gonna cover that later. If things go as CDPR says, you should expect around 60 FPS natively if you have a similar system and are using either an Arc A770, a Radeon RX 5700 XT, or a GeForce RTX 2060 Super. Now for our system, we actually dialed it down a bit, because when we looked at the CPU requirements, we saw either a 12700K and an AMD Ryzen 7 7800X 3D. We were actually surprised by the jump to the 7000 series for AMD, so we went down to a Ryzen 7 5800X 3D to see if it could still hit the bar. Spoiler alert, it can. I'm not sure why the jump CDPR, but it actually wasn't necessary. Now, rounding out the rest of the test system, we used an ASUS TUF Gaming B550M+, a 1TB Gen 4 NVMe drive from Kingston, and the same 16 gigs of DDR4 at 3200 mega transfers from TeamForce. So, how did things fare? Kicking it off with the Intel Arc A770 at 1080p with the highest graphical preset and ray tracing off and no upscaling, we saw an average frame rate of 67 FPS. Beautifully playable and nicely north of the 60 FPS butter zone we want to see. When we enable XeSS, we saw the frame rate jump up to 74.67 FPS, so if you want to really ensure you're well north of 60 FPS, you could do this, or you could even jump up to 1440p. On the AMD side of things, using the same presets as we did for Intel, we saw a native run of 71.15 FPS. That's great and should make for an epic run through Night City or Phantom Liberty. If you're down with the effects of upscaling, you're gonna be looking at closer to 100 frames per second, or more specifically 93.88 if you enable FSR at 1080p, and again, capable of jumping up to 1440p if you want to. Finally, we have the entry from Team Green with the NVIDIA RTX 2060 Super, and our first time getting to work with the world of DLSS. Using the same preset as Team Blue and Team Red, we saw our native run of the game average out at 72.25 FPS, which means a buttery experience in the game. Or you can enable DLSS and get the highest frame rate of all three cards at 97.61 FPS. Now, here is a nice little handy dandy chart to show a solid wrap up of the three cards, both running the game natively and with the appropriate upscaling technology. The short of it is that each of these cards were above the 60 FPS that CDPR claimed you would get, and by a healthy amount. So far, 2 for 2 from CDPR. Next up, we have UltraSpec. Given that UltraSpec also closely matches the recommended ray tracing spec at 1080p, we're gonna be giving you both sets of information here. First, we're gonna give you 4K Ultra with no ray tracing, both at native and with upscaling for the Radeon RX 7900 XTX, the RTX 3080 12GB, and the RTX 3080 Ti, as well as 1080p ray trace numbers for the RTX 3080 Ti and the 7900 XTX, both in native and with upscaling. If CDPR is correct, that means both at 4K without ray tracing and 1080p with ray tracing on Ultra, we should be getting 60 frames per second. Brian, you think we're gonna get 60 frames? Okay, what is unclear is if ray tracing is expected to be native without upscaling, but again, we're just gonna let our testing show what you actually get. For the system, we actually bumped up the CPU a bit with the Core i9-13900K over the 12900K, sorry. Didn't have a 12900K laying around. At 4K, this means almost nothing, but you could see slightly lower numbers if you're using a 12900 or 12900K. Honestly, we weren't sure what CDPR wanted here. We think they meant K. 1080p ray tracing is going to be a lot more CPU dependent, and we wanted to ensure that we pointed out that you could see a teensy bit difference, but we don't think it's gonna be that much. Now, in terms of the rest of the rig, we used an ASUS TUF Gaming Z690 Plus Wi-Fi, a 2TB Kingston Fury Gen 4 NVMe drive, and 32GB of Kingston Fury DDR5 at 6000 megahertz. So let's start off with the NVIDIA GeForce RTX 3080 12GB. With the 4K gameplay at ultra preset and native resolution, we saw the average FPS sitting at 48.76. Now that's playable, but if you want to play raw, I might recommend dropping down to 1440p. To be honest, I don't know why 1440p isn't in this chart. Now, when we turn on DLSS at quality, we also didn't quite hit that 60 FPS mark, and we were about 4 frames shy at 56 FPS. Honestly, if you have a 3080, it looks like dropping down to 1440p seems to be the better play, or you could drop down your graphical settings. I don't know, 1440p just seems better. Regardless, this is the first time we saw a recommendation from CD Projekt Red that didn't align with the 60 FPS number that they said it should hit. How about the 3080 Ti? Unfortunately, it's actually a similar story. They're pretty similar cards. At 4K resolution, at ultra preset, with no AI upscaling, we see things getting around 50 FPS, which is, again, playable, but not idyllic for 60 FPS, which is what most of us want. Popping DLSS at quality preset, we see things improve and get up to 56 FPS, but I'm kind of feeling the same recommendation as the 3080, that 1440p may be the better bet here. You can also try performance on DLSS, which will get you north of 60 FPS, but look at the visual quality first. Some people can see the difference. It just depends on who you are. Now, there is no shame at 1440p. It's a great resolution. Don't get tied up on 4K. Regardless, that's two strikes from CDPR on the Ultra recommendation. On Team Red, let's see if the flagship from AMD can handle the 2077, at 4K with no ray tracing at north of 60 FPS. What do you think? You think you can handle it? I think the answer is yes. Starting with native, the Ultra settings, we saw things running at a nice and smooth 67.97 FPS. Way to go, flagship, which is gonna be great. And if you wanna improve the frame rate even more, you can enable FSR 2.1 at quality and see that number jump to 80 FPS. So here it is, all wrapped up in a nice little bow that you can see here in this cool chart. The only native capable 4K card that they recommend at Ultra settings is the 7900 XTX from AMD. If you're looking for Team Green, it looks like the threshold is more than likely either the 4080 and maybe the 4070 Ti if you're looking for that non-ray trace ultra 4K graphic experience from Cyberpunk and the new expansion. Now for the crucible, and one of the super divisive features, ray tracing. It's a huge selling point for this game and what really makes this game one of the crown jewels of NVIDIA's technology and DLSS. I mean, see how the cards that were recommended for 4K Ultra and no ray tracing are now dropping down to 1080p to allow for ultra level ray tracing. Ray tracing is no joke. And with the newest addition of something called path tracing, it's almost getting to the point where upscaling AI technology like DLSS is actually required. Heck, Ray Reconstruction, the newest feature from NVIDIA, exists in part to the upscaling and denoising technology to improve and enhance it. It's not the focus of the video, but it's just definitely worth mentioning. So how did the 3080 Ti and 7900 XTX do with Ray Tracing Ultra at 1080p? Sorry, 3080, apparently you didn't make the cut. So kicking things off with Team Green, turning off DLSS and just running native with Ultra settings and Ray Tracing on Ultra, we saw an average FPS of 65 frames per second. That's playable. And if you're okay with running at native 1080p, then you're good to go. If we enable DLSS at quality, the average frame rate jumps up to almost 100 FPS. What this means that if you wanted to potentially go up to 1440p and still have ultra settings and ultra ray tracing, you could without an issue. And honestly, I would. So how about Team Red and their latest flagship GPU? Unfortunately, the native resolution at 1080p with ultra preset for ray tracing and graphics, we saw things at 53 FPS and a little bit off of that nice 60 FPS number some folks would want. However, we enable FSR 2.1 at the quality preset, we see that number jump up to 89.10 FPS. More than likely, again, jumping to 1440p is recommended here, especially if you did the preset at balance versus quality, which is actually recommended for this resolution. Now, looking at the graphs all up, we can see that Cyberpunk is either 1 for 2 or 2 for 2 if they meant with upscaling or not when it comes to ray tracing. Ray tracing is a graphical beast, and in most cases, upscaling is recommended. Regardless, this makes it easy to see where your system, if similar, might perform if you're looking to pick up the game. Now, the last thing in the chart, at the very end, is if you want to enjoy all the bells and whistles of the world, what kind of system would you need? Well, according to the team at CDPR, if you wanted to do 4K with path tracing, you need a 12900K with an RTX 4080 and 32 gigs of RAM. Now, this video is already long enough. In fact, Brian, wake up. Wait, gosh darn it, it's not that boring. Okay, and what we did is we basically built one of the best systems we could and run it through our gamut of tests. So this is for you high-end aficionados. You can decide if your high-end system has what it takes to run OP Cyberpunk. So with a 4090 in the bench and all the same specs as the 4K system recommendations, here is how things landed. For native, Yeah, don't bother with path tracing. The best we could get was 23.91 frames per second. Yeah, it's bad. And when we added frame generation, it only jumped to 43.22. So not worth it, and frankly, just go to Raytracing Ultra and enjoy like native 4K Cyberpunk with Raytracing and Ultra. However, the moment you add DLSS and you set it to auto, you see that jump above 60 frames per second sitting at 68.44. And if you want to improve the visual quality and have the best experience, you can also turn on Ray Reconstruction to get things to a whopping 72.06. Not to leave any frames on the table, even though they are AI generated frames, you can see things getting as high as 114.83 FPS with Ray Reconstruction and DLSS on auto, or you can drop down to 109.86 if you want to disable Ray Reconstruction. Which, why would you do that? Turn on Ray Reconstruction. So boys and girls, there you have it. The full gamut of our testing, and hopefully a much better picture of what to expect from your experience when you either pick up Cyberpunk 2077 or Phantom Liberty at launch or anytime post watching this video. I really, really do hope that this was helpful, and as we're newer to these videos, and based on your feedback we saw, we hopefully vastly improved from our Starfield video. If you have any additional feedback, please let us know down in the comments below. However, that's it for us. We hope you enjoyed this video, and if you did, please like and subscribe. We look forward to seeing you on the next one.